Hey, welcome, and thanks for tuning in to St. Andrews Presbyterian Church, Islington, and online everywhere. We encourage you to join in and participate with everything that you see and hear, and then also to share this video and like it, and to join us in a conversation about your responses. So sign in and leave us a comment. Let's talk. Christmas is coming, and it's a chance for us to remember that Jesus is God's light, and he shines in the darkness. Now, there is a lot of darkness around us these days with negativity and pessimism. And God knows how that affects us and how it makes us feel. But his joy is coming. Jesus, source of joy, shine in our lives and in this world with your life-giving joy. We light the candle of joy and take this chance to sing a song about God's joy.
Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. Romans 12:12.
When I said, my foot is slipping, your unfailing love, Lord, supported me. When anxiety was great within me, your consolation brought me joy.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant to me a willing spirit to sustain me.
Let every heart prepare a throne. loving Lord, as the world's situation seems to be more and more uncertain, we cling to you more closely than ever before and thank you that you are in control of our life and that nothing can separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Our joy doesn't come from our jobs, our families, our relationships, our finances, or our success. Our joy doesn't come from what we have on earth or who we are with. May we not mistake pleasure for joy. Joy always reminds. It is never a possession. It is always a desire for something longer ago or further away or still about to be. Our joy is a gift. It is the gift that you gave us. No earthly thing can ever complete our joy. Our joy comes from you, that joy that flooded the hearts of shepherds, angels, wise men, the hosts of heaven, and Mary and Joseph is the real, deep joy. Father, you offer that same joy to us now, if we know and recognize you as Savior and Lord. You gave us a reason to celebrate when you gave us the unspeakable gift of Jesus Christ. You came to dwell among us. You went to Calvary's cross for us. You overcame death and rose from the dead for us. You forgive our sins and give us eternal life. Father, flood our hearts with your perfect peace that passes understanding, that we may be immersed in your joy, knowing that your joy can be our strength for today and our bright hope for tomorrow. But Lord, we ask this not only for ourselves, but for all of those we love, and for our brothers and sisters in Christ, many of whom are facing various difficulties and escalating dangers in this increasingly problematic time. Thank you that as your children we can cling to your faithful promises, which are new every morning. Thank you for the joy of being in Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Way today. So we've been going through a pretty long build-up to Christmas this year, you think? Christmas can be a real struggle for many people. And I think this year, more than ever, Christmas can be a real struggle. I mean, just under normal circumstances, there's feelings of loneliness, there's feelings of isolation, and that's normal years. Now, this year, with our actual distancing, from one another through our COVID protocols and all that. This year, I think it's possibly more than ever. So the message today is especially for those who feel that they're struggling this Christmas. Now, if you're not struggling at all, I want to encourage you to listen in as well, because it may help you, just appreciate and understand some of the struggles that others may be going through. So again, I think there's been a long build-up to Christmas this year, longer than usual, I think. And, you know, Christmas music started playing on the radio this year earlier than ever. I mean, it was at least Remembrance Day, if not actually before that the first station began to play Christmas music. Although, I think we should put air quotes around Christmas music. Because as I read from a friend on Facebook the other day, he was noting that he was driving in a car with a seven-year-old. And just realizing how much sexual content there is in a lot of the Christmas music that's being played on the radio these days. But it's called Christmas music, certainly within the world in which we live, and it does kind of add to this build-up to what we experience, what we've come to call Christmas. And of course, decorations have also gone up sooner in a lot of houses around. Now, I don't want to give the impression that there's anything wrong with listening to Christmas music when it's not Christmas time, putting up decorations early and just kind of feeling the festiveness that can bring. There's nothing wrong with those things in and of themselves. And I think it's especially understandable, actually, this year. You know, the irony, I think, this year is that in this longest of Christmas seasons, if I'm right about that, I actually think we need Advent more than ever. You know, Advent wasn't part of my upbringing as a child in my family. You know, I might have gotten an occasional Advent calendar and enjoyed opening up the little doors, and especially if there was a chocolate in behind for me to enjoy. Of course, I did like that. But Advent is this season in the church year. Now, please understand, I don't tend to pay a lot of attention to the church year. But Advent is one of the few times, obviously Christmas and Easter being a couple of others, Advent is one of the times that I do pay attention, because it's come to be quite a special season for me, quite a precious season. Advent comes from a Latin word which simply means coming, one to come, something that is yet to come. Advent is about waiting for the coming of Christ at Christmas. Advent is about seeking God's presence. It's about recognizing our need for Him, our need for Jesus, and making room in our hearts and in our lives for Him. If you think about it, it's kind of like my Christmas tree that we just put up yesterday. See, the branches on my tree are still unfolding. It had been tied up for who knows how many days or weeks before we got it to our house here. But it takes time for our tree to be ready. It takes time for the branches to unfold, to unfurl after being tied up. And I think maybe that's something that Advent helps us to do, is after a feeling of being tied up and stressed, that maybe we just allow ourselves to wait for God and to allow ourselves to unfold naturally in His presence. Now, I think there are two main expressions of struggle at Christmas. Now, I'm sure we could get into more specifics and name many others, but I just want to look at two overall expressions of struggle at Christmas. The first one, I think, is a little bit more obvious, and that's this: just feeling down, coming out of your feelings of isolation, a feeling of melancholy, or possibly even just feeling depressed. You know, it's the shortest days of the year at this time. We're isolated and separated from our neighbors, our loved ones, even our co-workers. And so it's a struggle. And so that's one, maybe the more obvious expression of struggle at Christmas. The second expression of struggle, I think, is a little less obvious. And I think the way it comes out is by maybe kind of compensating. During the season, there are many festive things that we can participate in, although again, in a different kind of way this year. Maybe it is putting up the decorations. Maybe it is blaring the Christmas music on, you know, 98.1 or whoever's playing it these days. And we can kind of enter into that and enter that outward expression of festivity and joy at Christmas. But it can also be a front. Now, I'm not saying that being festive and everyone who is engaging in festive activities is secretly depressed, but it can be a face that we put on to mask our real feelings of isolation and melancholy and whatever the case may be at Christmas. course, the point in raising this isn't to ask you to look at others and say, are they putting on a mask? Or is that real festive feeling? No, it's really to look within ourselves. How are you feeling? How am I feeling? Am I struggling this Christmas? Are you? And these are questions that it's okay to ask ourselves. And it's important, even necessary, to do so. You see, Advent embraces the struggle. Advent and the season of Advent actually arises out of struggle. I don't think it's an easy season to fully enter into. I mean, we have these themes of hope and peace and joy and love, and that's great. It's wonderful. It's awesome. I love to remember them and celebrate through the Advent season every year. But understand that Advent is actually, at heart, it's a season of darkness. The reason we need to remember hope is because, well, there's a lot of hopelessness in the world. The reason we need to remember peace is because, well, there's a lot of conflict. The reason we need to remember joy is because there's so much grief and loss in normal years, let alone this year. The reason we need to remember love is because we live in a world that has much distance, loneliness, rejection. The struggle, my friends, is real. It's real for you, it's real for me, it's real for all of us. Now, as we look to the Bible, the quintessential Advent text, or at least to me, there certainly are more, but the quintessential Advent text to me are found in the Old Testament prophet Isaiah. Isaiah chapters 7 through 12 in particular. It's from these chapters that we get some very well-known verses. Maybe you'll recognize some of these. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. Love that. Emmanuel's Hebrew words that means God with us. Or we can turn to Isaiah 9, verse 6, a passage that we looked at last Sunday. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Or in Isaiah chapter 11, verse 6, the wolf will live with the lamb, the leopard will lie down with the goat, the calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. I love these verses. I love how they point us so clearly, although so many years before the coming of Jesus. They point us so clearly to him, and I appreciate that. And these things sound great, don't they? But let's not forget to read the rest. The rest of Isaiah 7 to 12. And I'm not going to do that today. That would take a little bit too much time. But maybe you would want to do that. It can be a little confusing, prophetic literature and language. But in general, the other texts and verses around it are pointing to the reality of war, the reality of threatened invasion. An analogy that he uses over and again are briars and thorns. What an image that is, briars and thorns rising up in our midst. Points to the Lord's anger, points to gloom and darkness, points to bitterness, and in one particularly strong image that is speaking to me this year in particular, talks about lofty trees being cut down and just mere stumps remaining. I could go on. But understand that these Advent texts that we love to focus on are placed within this larger context. And so I look at the world around me. I look at my life. I look at our reality of church these days and so much more. And I can relate. I can relate to this larger context. Because I look in the world, and what do we see? We see conflict. We see upheaval. We hear of, in the biblical term, wars and rumors of wars. There's famine happening. There's human trafficking. the plastic pollution in our seas and lakes and getting into sea life and things, it concerns me. I don't know what to do about it, but it's there. It's a concern. Just environmental degradation in so many different ways. And then, of course, there's COVID-19. We're in the midst of a global pandemic. Who ever thought that we here in Toronto or wherever it is that you live, whoever thought that this could possibly come upon us? The distancing that's gone along with it, the economic hardships, the job loss that some have experienced, the loneliness, so much. And then we could go further. We could just look at our experience in the church, for those of us who are more engaged in a local church. The local church over the last number of years has been, well, what's the right word? Constricting? Shrinking? Still going strong in so many ways and still such a good thing. And yet there is a feeling in me and perhaps in you that we're maybe beginning to feel like we're losing something. That we're losing steam, we're losing ground, we're losing, fill in the blank here. And then those of us in the Presbyterian Church in Canada and the current discussions that are being had over human sexuality and the remits, as we call them, that are before the denomination now about allowing same-sex marriage and ordination. And whatever view you have on the issue, just know there will be loss. There will be division. There will be struggle. And so as I look at the world, as I look at the church, as I look at my life, I feel these things. I resonate. Maybe you do too. But there's a text that has jumped out at me and just had a bit more depth and meaning for me this year than usual. Isaiah 11 begins with the words, "A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse." Let me read some more verses that go around that, starting at Isaiah 10, verse 33. "See, the Lord Almighty will lop off the boughs," like the trees, the boughs of trees, "will lop off the boughs with great power. The lofty trees will be felled. The tall ones will be brought low. He will cut down the forest thickets with an axe. Lebanon will fall before the mighty one." Lebanon, known for its tall cedar trees. Lebanon will fall before the mighty one. And then we go into chapter 11. "A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots, a branch will bear fruit. The spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the spirit of counsel and of might, the spirit of the knowledge and fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord." So like I said, that's jumped out at me. And in the past, when I've thought about this text, it's a well-known text to me and perhaps to some of you who are watching this video. I've always focused more on the shoot that's coming out from the stump. And that's appropriate, that's real. Again, this is a passage that points forward from the time of Isaiah to the coming of Christ. It points forward to hope, points forward to the joy of something that seemed dead, and a new shoot of life is springing forth. That's wonderful. And so focusing on the shoot, that's appropriate. But I must say, this year, I'm noticing the stump a lot more than I have in the past. You know, all of the words from Isaiah 7 to 12 are future-oriented. And what that means is that there is a current reality that is not this. Sure, we can look back today and we can see how so much of these chapters point to Jesus. Absolutely. We hear about Emmanuel, God with us. Here's Jesus. We hear about light coming into darkness. This is pointing to Jesus. We hear about the new shoots springing from the stump of Jesse. Jesse, the father of David. Jesus, the descendant, the son of David, the Messiah. Absolutely. This is wonderful, good news. And yet, even today, even though we can look back to the coming of Jesus, there is still, I believe, a future element here for us too. Because we still walk in, we still experience the darkness, the difficulties, the struggles of this world, of our lives. And so the reality can be very much more like the stump for you and for me sometimes. Feeling cut off, feeling brought low, feeling like your best days are behind you. Let's come back to my Christmas tree for a moment, if you will. Think about this question. What would you rather be? Would you rather be the Christmas tree, or would you rather be the stump? See, I think most of us would say we'd rather be the tree. I mean, my tree is pretty bare still at the moment, but we'd rather be the tree because we like the idea of the festive feeling that it brings. We maybe like the piney smell that it gives off if we have a real tree. And the tree just in itself is just beautiful. It's a creation of God. It's there's a beauty in it, let alone once it has all the decorations and it takes on just another level of beauty. It's wonderful. But here's the thing. The tree is dead. No matter how much tinsel we put on it, no matter how many different colored lights we string around it, no matter how many silver and gold garlands we're able to string around it, the tree's dead. It has been cut down. It has been cut off. You know, we say things like, as time goes on, the needles will get brown and it will die. But the reality is, it's already dead. Now think about the stump. The stump isn't beautiful. The stump is definitely a feeling of having been brought low. Maybe if you were the stump, you would have memories of good days gone by. Maybe a little stump, especially for a Christmas tree-sized tree, you know, a little stump gets lost on the forest floor as other things grow up around it and it feels maybe left behind, left out. But here's the thing. The stump is still rooted. The stump is still rooted. And only in the stump is there a readiness and an ability for new life to spring up, right? A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. Not the trunk that's been cut down and carted away and made into something else, put up as a Christmas tree, built into whatever else, no. But from the stump, a shoot will come up. Shoot won't come off the tree. It can't. Only the stump, because the stump is rooted. Now, Advent, I think, invites us into the sense of stumpness. I don't think that's a word. But it invites us to inhabit this sense of stumpness, to recognize the darkness, to recognize the difficulties, to not ignore them, to overlook them, but to name them. I appreciate that Advent meets me in these things, that in Advent I'm invited to inhabit that space and to know that it's okay to do so. I love that Advent acknowledges the stump, and that Advent holds out the promise of renewal and new life. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse, and it goes on, from his roots, the stump is rooted, from his roots a branch will bear fruit. So are you struggling this Christmas? Maybe you need to slow down or back away from the festivity, the trappings of Christmas, and allow yourself to experience the darkness of Advent first. Some of you who know me may know I have a little cabin that I like to go up to in the woods. It's built on, you know, some family property that my father owned and now my brother owns. But I have this just small cabin. love going there. And sometimes when I would be up there, when my dad was still living up there, he's moved now, but I digress, I would go from his house, I'd be, you know, maybe spend the evening there, have dinner with them, and then I would walk back to my cabin after it was dark. Now, even though I would have my phone with me and there would be a flashlight on my phone, I really liked trying to walk from my dad's to my cabin, which under normal circumstances would have been about maybe a 10-minute walk, 8 minutes maybe. But I loved doing it in the dark, with no flashlight whatsoever. Now, on some nights the moon was out and there'd be a good bit of light for me to see. But I liked it especially when there was no moon, maybe just a few stars, or sometimes even a cloudy sky. Now, how did I find my way in the darkness? What I would have to do, and especially as I was walking from the field that I had to cross into the woods, and then along the pathway through the woods to my cabin, you know what I had to do? I couldn't see anything if I just looked straight in front of me. It was all just black, it was all dark. So what I had to do was, I had to look up. And as I looked up, I could see the outline of the trees. I could see the stars in the sky, or again, maybe just a gray, cloudy backdrop. But I could see that there was light, even in the midst of that darkness. And as I looked up, I could recognize certain formations of trees, and I would know if I was on the right path. Now, believe me, I did walk into the odd tree here or there. That did happen. But for the most part, I was able to do it by looking up, by looking for the light that it didn't seem was there, but the light that was present even in the midst of the darkness. It was dim, but there was light, and I was able to look up and to follow the way forward. My friends, don't feel like you need to rush forward into Christmas. I would encourage you to walk, to inhabit the season of Advent, to walk through Advent, to feel the darkness, to feel the struggle, to feel the difficulty, not to wallow in it, not to think there is no hope, there is no light. Of course not. There is light in the darkness. My friends, as you walk through Advent, as you maybe ponder these passages from Isaiah or elsewhere in Scripture, my friends, let's look up. Let's look up into the sky. Let's look up into the light that is present and allow it to lead us forward, maybe slowly, maybe with stumbling steps, maybe with an odd pitfall here and there. But let us look up. Let us walk forward. Let us allow hope to arise, to allow peace to descend. And perhaps like a new shoot springing up from an old stump, let us allow joy to peek out, to grow. Lord Jesus, Master of both the light and the darkness, send your Holy Spirit upon our preparations for Christmas. We who have so much to do, seek quiet spaces to hear your voice each day. We who are anxious over many things, look forward to your coming among us. We who are blessed in so many ways, long for the complete joy of your kingdom. We whose hearts are heavy, seek the joy of your presence. We are your people, walking in darkness, yet seeking the light. To you, we say, come, Lord Jesus.
Rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember, Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. In Bethlehem in Jewry, the blessed babe was born and laid within a manger upon this blessed morn, to which his mother Mary did nothing take in scorn. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Father, a blessed angel came, and unto certain shepherds brought tidings of the same, how that in Bethlehem was born the Son of God by name. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. The Lord sing praises, all you within this place, and with true love and fellowship each other now embrace. This holy tide of Christmas all other doth deface. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy.
Thank you. My friends, the time has come for us to now go our separate ways, to leave this time that we've shared together. In some ways, this is the most important moment of any worship service, because it's the moment that we are sent out to go and be the church. And so, my friends, whatever circumstances we find ourselves in, whether we are feeling festive and joyful, whether we are feeling melancholy and down, whether we are feeling like the great mighty tree or just the little stump, know that the Lord is with you. The promise of Emmanuel is true, and it is for you and for each one of us. And so go knowing that God is with you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Go in peace. Amen.
Hello. Thank you for watching our online worship service today. We appreciate you spending time with us. Subscribe, like, or leave a comment or question below, and we'll get back to you. I'm really pleased that over 630 Christmas cards were dropped off at the church. I'll be calling those who have received cards to arrange pickup. Thank you to those who have offered to deliver cards to your neighbors. Christmas time is an exciting time, but it can also be a time of great need. Please continue to donate new men's, women's, and children's socks for delivery to our mission partners, the Scott Mission and the Yonge Street Mission. The church will be open every Thursday between 11 a.m. and 1 p.m. for your donations, or you can slip an individual pair through the mailbox on the west-facing Beamish doors. On this third Sunday of Advent, we can look forward to upcoming services, like the 9 Lessons and Carols on December 20th, a very special Christmas Eve service on December 24th, a family Christmas play on December 27th, and evening services of prayer on December 27th and January the 3rd. If you would like to receive our weekly preview email with a link to these services and special alerts, sign up on our website. The year end is fast approaching, and we thank you for your continued financial support, which provides for the life, work, and ministries of St. Andrews Islington through e-transfers to office@standrewsislington.org, by hitting the donate button on the website, or through the pre-authorized donation program. Offering envelope packages are available, and you can call or email me to arrange pickup. Now let's catch up with some of our St. Andrews friends. See you next time.
Well, hi once again. One last minute announcement that's just kind of hot off the presses as we put the video together for this weekend. As great news, our friends Victor and Angelique Mpwabankanza have had a new baby son to add to their family, and we're so, so glad for them. If you don't know Victor and Angelique, or if you're just trying to remember, because it has been a little while since we've been together, here's a photo of when we were able to get together a little over a year ago in better times. But Victor and Angelique, and Smith and Anna, our blessings, our best wishes, our congratulations go out to you. May the Lord bless you and keep you and your growing family now and always. Blessings in Jesus' name.
Hello, everybody at St. Andrews. It's really a privilege to talk to you, separated by an ocean, but the technology is just so easy to be right there with you. Well, we're here. In spite of the pandemic, we're here. We were able to fly to Paris on August 12th during the quiet period between the waves, get our lodging, and then when we got here, we were able to visit Suzanne's mother in Geneva, organize a funeral, proper funeral service for her dad as well at the same time. So right now we're involved with two churches in the Paris area. I've been doing transitional pastoral work. That's helping churches to go from one pastorate to another. And we're still getting to know everybody in both congregations, and despite the second lockdown. And we're currently helping both congregations turn the page after their beloved pastors have departed and begin to think strategically for the future. So thank you for your prayers. And newsletter is going out. And by the time you hear this, maybe you will already have read it. God bless.
Just wanted to bring birthday greetings once again to Lang Fleming. It's Lang's 80th birthday this past week. In fact, it was Lang's birthday last Sunday. Only I overlooked that and didn't hear about that until it was a little too late to include it in last Sunday's video. But we did want to take a moment now and just offer birthday blessings and greetings to you, Lang. We're so glad that you and Yvonne have been and continue to be just an important part of our family at St. Andrews. Blessings.
Going to have another cake to celebrate your birthday, Lang. I love your smile and your encouraging words. Keep it up. Happy birthday.
We want to wish you a happy birthday, Lang. We hope you have a good birthday. We pray that you will have many more birthdays to come, and God bless you.
Happy birthday, Lang, and thanks for all the work that you've done leading Lang's gang and doing the work around the church. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Lang. 110, and you got 80, a bonus.
Happy birthday, Lang. I will always remember and treasure your testimony from Hong Kong when you went to help Jackie Pullinger with the homeless and drug addicts. Hope you can share it with all of us one day.
Happy birthday, Lang. It's always so good to see your smiling face and your readiness to help in so many situations. May God continue to bless you all your days. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Lang. We miss you. Ingrid and I really miss going to your Revelation Bible study. On her behalf and all the gang, happy birthday.
Hi, Lang. It was good to be in the Tuesday crew with you.
Happy birthday, Lang.
Happy birthday, Lang. Remember all the times working on the Last Supper presentations and also just your cheerfulness and willingness to do the work around the church. And we thank you for that blessing. So happy birthday.
For as long as I've known you, you have served as an excellent role model for our church. For our church to grow, we will need more people like you. Hope you had a great day.
Happy birthday, handyman.
Hi, Lang. Happy birthday to you. I have appreciated so much. You have been such a vital part of our community. And thank you for the real boost you gave to prayer ministry.
Happy birthday, Lang. It's been a real pleasure knowing you and working with you and seeing your pleasant and positive nature. And as you enjoy your 80th birthday, actually, I guess it's a belated birthday. Just want to remind you of Psalm 121 and just some of the things in it. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. And really glad that that is true for all of us. He will keep your life. Blessings.
Lang, I hope you have a very happy 80th birthday. I miss seeing your face every Tuesday when you came into the church, and I just wish blessings upon you. Happy 80th.
Hi, Lang. It's a good time to wish you a happy birthday and to let you know that we will never forget getting arrested in the United States with you. It was a pleasure the whole time. Thank you so much for that memory. Happy birthday.
She's got a wicked sense of humor, doesn't she? Happy birthday, Larry.
Ian, just wanted to say happy birthday to you. And now that
I know that Willis is comfortable in his new digs. I think at 80, you're going to be the official old fart of the group. So happy birthday and enjoy.
Happy birthday, Lang. You've been such a blessing to St. Andrews and to us, and we are so glad to have you in our lives. May God bless you on your birthday and in this coming year. May he keep you safe, and may he bring joy into your life.
Happy birthday, Lang. We miss seeing you. Take care.
And so, Lang, from all of us, blessings upon you. We just wanted to take this opportunity to say
happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Blessings, my friend.